Simon & Schuster Audio presents Carolina Built, a novel by Kianna Alexander, read by Shayna Small, with Leon Nixon.
For the women in my family line, both known and unknown to me, whose love, courage, and sacrifices allowed me to come into being, and for my daughter, and the dream of all she will one day become. Preface. I first heard of Josephine Napoleon Leary's story from a tweet, a simple blip on my feed. A chance encounter with someone else's thoughts led me to write this book. It's funny because I was forced into using Twitter by a writer friend who insisted I'd need it for networking. I was already exhausted with Facebook, being a private person by nature. I fought tooth and nail, but finally caved and got a Twitter account in 2011. Nowadays, I use it far more than any other social media site. When I saw the tweet about Mrs. Leary, I was immediately intrigued. I was also upset that as a native North Carolinian, I had never heard of her or her accomplishments. In eighth grade, I was required to take a state history class, one that was supposed to have given me an in-depth picture of North Carolina, from its first colonies to the 20th century. Where was the mention of Mrs. Leary, whose remarkable accomplishments should have more than secured her place in the annals of state history? Years of independent research to satisfy my own insatiable curiosity about my history have shown me that this is often the case. The accomplishments of African Americans have so often been minimized, overlooked, or outright dismissed to serve a narrative that relegates us to the status of second-class citizenship. I decided to be a part of the solution, by putting my efforts into a project that would shine a light on someone who would otherwise be forgotten by history. I began my research, as most of us do in this age of technology, online, using the digital archives of the Josephine Napoleon Leary papers, housed at the David M. Rubenstein Rare Book and Manuscript Library on the campus of Duke University. I was able to establish a baseline of knowledge about Mrs. Leary's life and work, particularly as it pertains to her finances and her real estate transactions. The collection, acquired from Mrs. Leary's grandson, Percy Almeria Reeves, in 1991, has been an invaluable source of information. Most of the factually verifiable information known about Mrs. Leary's life is sourced from the materials in this collection. My assistant and I first traveled to Duke University to visit the reading room at the Rubenstein Library. As a registered researcher there, I'd requested the two boxes of items from the Josephine Leary papers that had not been digitized to be brought up for my inspection. Holding the papers that Mrs. Leary herself handled only served to increase my level of passion and excitement for this project. We then traveled to Edenton to get a firsthand look at Mrs. Leary's building, which is still standing today and in very good condition thanks to faithful exterior restoration. The building currently houses the local newspaper, the Shawan Herald. We spent several hours touring the town on foot, visiting the historic Edenton State Historic Site, the site of Josephine's old barbershop at 317 South Broad Street, and Shepherd Pruden Memorial Library. We found valuable sources at all these locations, both in the form of documents and of helpful staff. Our walking tour also afforded us a view of many stately homes of the era, giving us a peek into life at that time. At the library, I became the grateful recipient of a copy of the booklet, The Life and Legacy of Josephine Napoleon Leary, 1856 to 1923, by Dorothy Sproul Redford. Mrs. Redford, a noted historian and former site manager of the Somerset Place State Historic Site in Cresswell, North Carolina, compiled the booklet from primary source research during the 2010s. The 47-page booklet is, thus far, the most in-depth writing that has ever been done on Mrs. Leary's life, and it has enhanced my research immensely. I've spent the better part of the past 2 years combing through historical databases, newspaper clippings, and scholarly articles to form a solid basis of knowledge on the life Mrs. Leary lived. And now that the book is finally in the hands of you, the reader, I'm proud to share the fruits of my efforts. It is my hope that you will be just as inspired by Josephine Napoleon Leary's amazing life as I am. Prologue. July 1870, Williamston, North Carolina.
Josephine! Josephine! Don't you hear me calling you, child?
Snapped back to reality by the sound of my grandmother's exasperated voice, I close my worn copy of Shakespeare's Macbeth. In the doorway of my family's small cabin is my grandmother, Millie. She is dressed in her typical working uniform of tan blouse and earth-grazing brown skirt, her silver curls wrapped and tucked beneath a red scarf. Her brows are furrowed, her jaw tight.
Heavens, Joe, it's good that you read like you do, but you get so wrapped up in those books, nobody can reach you.
Grandma Millie shakes her head.
You liable to miss the rapture, child.
I answer her with a crooked grin. Sorry, Grandma. What do you need?
I need you to get out here in the yard and help me with Mr. Stutt's laundry.
She props her fists on her hips, as she's apt to do when she's about to lecture me.
These linens ain't gonna wash themselves.
Yes, ma'am. I tuck my beloved book beneath my low cot, climb to my feet, and follow Grandma Millie out into the front yard. The moment I step outside, the heat of early summer in North Carolina meets me, and I groan.
It's hot out, Grandma.
You're telling me.
Grandma Millie chuckles as we move across the crispy brown grass.
So hot out here, it could fry the curls right out of your head.
She reaches over, tousling my hair. I cringe, knowing that if she upsets my bun, it will be hard to wrestle my thick waves back into submission. We stop walking as we approach Grandma Millie's washing station. Two large, galvanized tubs, each outfitted with a washboard, sit in the grass. One suds-filled tub stands ready for washing. The other is filled with clear water for rinsing. Each wash tub boasts a crank-operated wringer, poised to squeeze every drop of water out of Mr. Stutz's bedspreads and pillow slips. Beyond that, we have six sturdy poles from which Grandma Millie has strung the clothesline on which the freshly laundered items will dry, and a small basket containing wooden clothespins.
All right, time to call on the muscle of this operation.
Cupping her hands around her mouth, Grandma yells,
Octavius, come on and bring the laundry.
Yes, ma'am,
his small voice calls back. A few blinks later, here comes my little brother, pushing a wheelbarrow full of dirty laundry. His brown shorts and worn, once white, shirt are streaked with dirt, as always. Parking the wheelbarrow near the wash tubs, Octavius asks,
Can I go play now, Grandma?
Grandma Millie smiles at him.
In a minute. First, get your mama. We're gonna need some more help with this washing.
Yes, ma'am.
He runs off. Octavius is a ball of energy, most of which he uses to run around the farm, climbing trees and troubling the hens. Mama says he was born under the wandering star, and that's why he can't keep still. Octavius comes back with Mama, whose attire is similar to Grandma Millie's. Mama isn't wearing the headscarf she normally wears. Instead, she's wound her long, wavy hair into a tight bun on top of her head like me. Mama walks over with a smile and pinches my cheek.
Finished reading that play again, honey?
I shake my head.
Not yet.
This is what? The fourth time you're reading it?
Sixth. I reckon I'll finish it in the next few days.
Grandma scoffs.
Honey child, how are you gonna find a husband if your nose is always buried in a book? You ought to look up once in a while. You never know who might be nearby.
I shrug. I suppose it'll have to be a man who likes to read. Mama sighs.
Anyhow, we just want to make sure there's somebody to look after you when we're gone.
Gone? You two are gonna always be with me.
My mother and grandmother exchange a look, but neither of them speaks. We women folk set about the task of the Stutz family laundry, while Octavius busies himself climbing trees. Mr. Stutz, a pretty well-known lawyer in town, hired Grandma Million as his personal washerwoman after emancipation. I was a girl of 9 at the time, and my brother was around 7. Ever since we left the plantation, we've been working as free blacks on a small corner of his land. The plot and our one-room cabin built upon it are considered part of Grandma's pay. It isn't a fancy life by any means, but near as I can tell, it's far better than it used to be. The best part of being free is that I can read whenever I want and not get into trouble for it. That is, as long as I keep up with my chores. I took many a whipping from our old mistress for my desire to educate myself. Mrs. Stutz is nice enough to loan me books, since I always give them back in good condition. Reading is my favorite way to pass the time, and whenever I get the chance, I love to find a quiet corner and dive into a good story. I love to read about different times and different places and all the lives that people can live. Bent over the rinsing tub, Mama says, "My stars, it's mighty warm out here."
"Nothing's quite as hot as a North Carolina summer,"
Grandma Millie chuckles.
"I mean, other than hail."
Mama shakes her head.
"The hot weather always reminds me of summers gone by, you know, Mama. It's been 5 summers since we walked free from Master Williams. 12 summers since I had Octavius, 14 since I had Joe, and 15 since Colonel Lamb first visited the plantation."
Grandma Millie gives Mama a look.
"Jeanette, why are you always talking about that white man? No good's gonna come of it."
Mama runs the bedsheet she's been rinsing through the wringer and heads for the clothesline. She stoops, snatching up a few clothespins, then tosses the sheet over the line.
"Mama, that man knows he fathered these children. Why else would he send me that portrait of him and that little bit of money that we put toward outfit in the cabin?"
Grandma Millie just shakes her head.
"That's neither here nor there. I'm not saying he didn't sire these children, just like 100 other white men who tipped into the quarters when we had no other choice."
She works a pillow slip over the washboard, stirring up a heap of suds in the hot, lye-laced water.
"What I'm saying is, it don't make any difference to your life or to my grandbabies. You and me, we the ones that's gonna make sure these children are all right."
I separate the pieces of laundry to hand to Grandma for washing, then carry them over to Mama for rinsing. Mama and Grandma don't talk about Colonel Lamb very often, especially when I'm around, so I follow with interest. I know the Colonel is the stern-looking, dark-eyed man who sired me, then denied me. I suppose he's simply doing what other men of his status do, but I try not to think on him too much. All I know is the folks with me right here, right now, are my family. My grandma, my mama, and my worrisome brother are my family. They love me, and I love them right back. Not knowing both of one's parents is a common predicament, so to me it makes no difference if my father comes around or not. The 4 of us have been doing just fine without him. The sounds of wheels rolling over rutted earth and the clopping of horses' hooves make me turn my eyes toward the road. Seeing an approaching buggy, I point at the vehicle.
"Somebody's coming."
As it stops in front of our yard, Grandma Millie drops the pillow slip into the rinse tub and wipes her hands on the front of her skirt.
"I wonder who it is."
The laundry work stops as we watch a bespectacled white man carrying a notebook walk up the steps to the Stutz's front porch.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.